10 moving up to 11. Man, I just kind of think back. 10 years old. That seems so long ago for me. Yes, I used to be at 10 at one time in my life. And then when I think about Anna, well, it really didn't seem that long when she was 10 years old. I have this story to share. When Anna first turned 10, I always kind of thought, well, one day Anna's going to grow old and she's going to start dating guys. And, you know, that's the reality, right? You guys, eventually you get to the point where you're going to start to date girls, and girls are going to start to date guys, and that's the reality of life, right? So I'm kind of thinking, okay, Anna's going to one day meet some guy, and I just want to set the bar high. You know, I just want to show her what a man should treat a lady, you know. Like, and so at the age of 10, I decided to take her out for dinner. Like, it was a fancy restaurant. Some of your parents would probably know Cannery Seafood Restaurant, and it's not around anymore, but back then it was a real, you know, it's a hot spot. And so I kind of thought, I'll take Anna. We would dress up formal. I'd wear my suit, and then Anna would wear her formal Chinese gown, and she really got decked up. I bought her a corsage. I bought her a little gift. And, you know, this was a real date, and it's a big deal. And so we go to Cannery, and then with Anna, it's funny, because she always ordered the same thing. Like, when we got there, anything in the menu, like, you can order whatever you want. But Anna always ordered pasta. Like, she just loves pasta. And so, you know, I kind of thought, okay, if you want pasta, that's fine. So anyways, we had this wonderful time, and it was just a time of father-daughter bonding. I just loved that, that time in our lives. And I remember that she was so sweet-looking. I kind of thought, man. See, Anna, she's going to always be my little princess. She's always going to be my baby girl. You know, like, when I look at her now, I kind of thought, wow, she's actually a teacher. She's teaching grade 5. But then when I look at her, she's still my baby girl. And I'm sure some of your parents, they look at you and you're 10 years old and moving on to 11, they look at you and they kind of think, you're still my baby boy, or you're still my baby girl. Right? That's just the way it is. Anyways, this is one of the most precious possessions in my life. It's actually one of the first serious notes that Anna wrote me. And I always keep it by my office, always by my desk. I'm just going to read it to you. It says, this is April 2003. Dear Dad, thanks for the date on Friday. This will be one of my best memories. Thanks for the precious moment, the corsage, the dinner, the Archie comic. You know, of course, you know, what's a date without an Archie comic, right? We should do this again one day. Maybe next month. Maybe it doesn't have to be too fancy. And I kind of thought, phew. How about someday it could be fancy and someday it doesn't? I love you, Daddy, from your little princess, Anna. But she kind of wrote something weird. She wrote Anna Chu as though I need to know her last name. And then it goes on, P.S., sort of a reminder, Dad, when shall we go again? On May? You know, like, she's kind of making the date ahead of time already. So, yes, Anna said that her dad is a comic geek. I grew up collecting comics. And I still love comics. As a matter of fact, when people look at my kids and they realize there's a lot of things that they learn to love in life, and one of them is actually gaming. I mean, how many are you guys are gamers? You like video games? Oh, no, most of you, right? Well, see, in our household, we always had the latest video game. We always had when PlayStation came out, we got that. When PlayStation 2 came out, we got that. PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4. And Anna used to joke, you know, once you're a granddad, probably PlayStation 20, and you'll bring the grandkids over to play at your house, right, Dad? And I said, yeah, probably. You know, every video consoles that you can think of, Xbox, Xbox 360, Xbox One, Xbox One S, Xbox One, One X, have them all. And so that's the type of life that Anna grew up in. She's always immersed in video gaming. Well, You know, when she asked me to share today with you guys about my testimony, I kind of have to think back about just the fact that my kids grew up in a Christian home. And I realized that a lot of things that Anna and my son Sam has in life, I don't know if they take it for granted, but then when I look at them and I kind of thought, wow, it's, to me, my kids are always a blessing to me. But then I also realized one thing is that growing up in a Christian home is such a blessing too, because I didn't grow up in a Christian home. You know, I grew up in a home where there was a lot of disruption. I have a mom and dad that always were not in a good marriage. As a matter of fact, it was an abusive marriage. I mean, it's a sad thing when you grow up in a home, because I think that every home should have a loving mom, a loving dad. You know, mom and dad should get along. But unfortunately, when I grew up in my household, that wasn't the case. And so I saw a lot of things happening. And despite of that, I always kind of thought, well, my mom really tried to raise up for her children. She was a great mom. You know, she always bought me the nicest stuff, you know, whatever money that she had. We weren't very rich at the time. And so mom really tried to provide for us. But nevertheless, just having that disruption, that tension at home, I remember that we were fearful of our father. You know, because he was always an angry person. Sometimes he would take out on my mom, and sometimes he takes out on his kids. And so every time dad comes home, we were just fearful. We would want to run to the basement. We just want to hide. And that's a terrible way to live. I don't think that any kid should have that type of a life. And so I kind of think of my kids. And I knew that at a very young age that when I have my own family, I'm going to love my kids. I'm going to have some kids, and I always knew I was going to have a boy and a girl. And that's something I believe that the Lord spoke to my heart about. And so when my kids came, I remember the first time when Anna came into the world, I thought this is the most beautiful thing ever. Like I remember just coming home from work, and I would just go straight to the crib, and I would literally look at her for half an hour, just staring at her, every little movement. It was just so precious. And I kind of think back to it's a little funny how I looked at my kids. They were like, to me, they were like little pets. You know, everything that I did with them, it's just so precious. I remember when we first started to try to get Anna to eat solid food, we videotape a lot of these highlight moments. We videotape her first bath. We videotape her first moments of a lot of different things that she's done in life. And I remember, Anna is such a good baby. You know, we had friends that had these babies that cried all the time, a colicky baby, they're constantly crying. As a matter of fact, I had one friend that called me up one time, and he says, Ed, you know, my baby, she's constantly crying, what do I do? And I said, well, Alex, it's simple. You grab a pillow, you put it over her head, and you wait for a minute. And then there's complete silence on the other side. And I said, Alex, I'm just joking. I said, just pick her up, you know, just talk to her, move her around. But Anna, she was a very good baby. Like she hardly cried. She wakes at the right time. She eats at the right time. And as a matter of fact, you know, sometimes I know parents, when they have their firstborn, they have to kind of take turn looking after the baby, right? And none of them, or the couple can't eat together. Well, we just put Anna on top of the table, the kitchen table, and we'll both be eating, and we're just looking at her. She was just going, cooling and watching us. And that's just how tight the Anna was. The way I talk about Anna, you know that I'm pretty proud of her, right? I just love her. Kids. Let me tell you a story. It's not a true story. It's just a story. There was this man who was horseback riding. He was just riding along this nice plateau in the canyon. You know, it's a beautiful day, sunshine, you look at the view, the beautiful view, you know, the ranges of the canyon. And so he has his horse go close to the cliff up this edge. And then suddenly a flock of birds fly out, spooking the horse. The horse jolts back and the guy flies off the horse, rolls onto the cliff, and he's hanging under. And next thing you know, can you picture this? He's hanging on and then he slips And then he grabs onto this tree limb that happened to be sticking on the cliff. And so he's hanging on there for dear life. Looking down, and it's like a 500 feet drop. I mean, it's quite precarious. And so here he is panicking, he's shouting, "Help! Help!" I mean, you know, he's ready to fall, right? And here he is in the midst of this crisis. He hears this loud, booming voice. I'm here to help. And he goes, "Is that you, God?" "Yes." And then he shows, hang on, he's always so relieved. He goes, "God, you gotta help me." And then God says, "Let go." He's hanging on, he's looking down, he goes, "Let go." "Let go." So he's kind of thinking to himself, and he goes, "Help! Is there anybody else up there?" I'm going to talk about trusting in God. Like, sometimes, as a child of God, it's a process of learning how to trust in Him. And of course, I don't believe that any of us would get into that precarious position of being hanging on a cliff. But then sometimes when we face difficulties or problems or challenges in life, it can't feel that way. You know what I mean? I'd like to say at the age of 10, you shouldn't have a whole lot of worry that your life is ahead of you and it's just going to be wonderful and rosy. But unfortunately, as we grow, as we change, there's going to be difficulty along the way. There always is. There are always going to be little challenges that come along the way, whether it's going to be a test and, you know, once you get into high school and once you graduate, going to university, having to get into a certain place, you know, having to decide on a career. Like, there are different things that will come along. And then, of course, as you grow older, you get into relationships. And another thing, once you get into a relationship, it brings on a whole new things of challenges as well. And so it's a good thing to learn at an early age to realize one thing about God, that He is trustworthy. That's something that I had to learn later on in my life. Like I said, I didn't grow up in a Christian home. I grew up in a home where my mom was an idol worshiper. She worshiped this, you know, some of you that are from an Asian background, if you have grandparents, if they're not Christian, they're probably most likely worshiping idols or ancestral worship. And I remember my mom used to have a picture of this ancient god, and then beside the god would be the picture of my grandfather, which is for ancestral worship. And of course, my mom, being a very religious person, I mean, she wasn't a Christian, she just believed in God, or she believed in a lot of gods. And so, just to cover her ground, she used to have this little altar outside of the basement. And I used to ask her, "Well, what's that for, Mom?" And she would say, "That's for the God of the heaven." And so every morning she would burn incense to her idol, to my grandfather, ancestral worship, and then she would put some incense outside for the God of heaven. So she covered her ground. And I remember as a little kid, I used to, I don't know if you guys even come across these anymore, but they used to have these colored by, or paint by numbers. You know, you have this paint set and they have these numbers and you just kind of follow the number code and you paint. Well, this paint by number thing is the painting of Jesus. And so I remember painting it and I was pretty proud of it. And I thought, "Hey, Mom, what do you think?" And so Mom was never against Jesus. She kind of thought he's just one of another God, and he was a wonderful God, it's fine. And I said, "Well, Mom, can I put the painting of Jesus right beside your idol and Grandpa?" And she goes, "Oh, no, you know, that'll get into the wars of the gods. it's going to be taboo." And I kind of thought, "Oh, really? Like, why don't they get along?" Well, she didn't allow me. So anyways, I grew up having a religious mom, but not really knowing about the reality of Christ. Well, growing up was kind of tough for me. I mean, I know right now at the age of 10, I think life should be wonderful. It ought to be wonderful. But then, see, as you get into your older years, when change starts coming into your body, you know, you're going to start to sprout something, you're going to start to sprout in a few years. Your voice is going to start to change. Instead of sounding like Mickey Mouse, you're going to sound like, you know, like a deep, low voice, like a radio sports announcer. You know, things start to happen. And I remember when things start to change in my life, well, you know, you start to run around with friends, and in high school, there's a thing what you call peer pressure. And unfortunately, you know, growing up as a young person, you're going to go through a time of peer pressure, maybe even now. But sometimes it's good if you have friends that are always going to do the right thing. But it's not so good if you have friends that are a bit on the rebellious side. They want to do the things that are kind of not good, right? And then sometimes when you hang around with people like that, because of peer pressure, you want to be accepted, you want to be cool, you want to be one of the crowd, then you start to do the things that you know. Like your parents have taught you, maybe for all your years, that these things are not right. It's wrong. And that's exactly what I've gone through. That my mom always taught me how to choose the right friends and, you know, how to be a good moral person. I mean, even though she wasn't a Christian, but she always thought, okay, if you live as a person, you should be a good person. You shouldn't do bad things. But of course, you know, as a teenager, and if you have friends that do bad things, then guess what? You're going to do bad things, right? And so I end up running around with a crowd that like to do the partying, that like to do the drinking, that like to do the drugs. And I remember that every time I did it, I felt that there was something not right. But then, of course, I wanted to be accepted. And so I continued on with that lifestyle to the point where I remember at one party, it was just so bad. It was really bad because people were so high. And I'm talking about now, I'm in my late teens. But it was so bad, I just remember going in and I'm looking at all my friends and they were just so out of it. You know, the people that I thought were cool at one time, but now I'm looking at them and they're so stoned out of their mind. And I'm looking at one by one. And I kind of thought, what am I doing here? And I remember that time. I went to the mirror in the bathroom, I'm looking at myself. I don't even recognize myself. I kind of thought, who are you? And that freaked me out because literally, I'm looking in a mirror, I couldn't recognize who I was. And it freaked me out. It freaked me out to the point where I just got into this deep, deep depression for months that I couldn't shake. And it got to the point where I kind of thought, I'm fearful of the future. I'm fearful of what life offers. I came from a family that was full of disruption, full of tension. And I remember at the time, in my late teens, my mom, she was fighting depression because, you know, she had such a terrible marriage. And this is what I heard daily. It's better to be dead. It's better to just not exist. My life is so horrible. I mean, that's what I'm hearing every day in my late teens. And it just got to me, to the point where I kind of thought to the point where I start to agree with her. I kind of thought, yeah, it's probably true. It's better to be dead. And so about 2 months before my 20th birthday, I attempted suicide. And I remember, you know, I just overdosed on sleeping pills, and I kind of thought, well, this is the end. I just went to bed, and I figured I was just going to not exist anymore. Well, anyways, what happened was my mom knew something was wrong. She broke down my door in my bedroom. Saw that I was out of it, knew something was wrong, called the emergency, it rushed me into the hospital, pumped my stomach. And I remember at that point in time, I'm in this hospital, it's all white, and I'm kind of coming to, and I kind of thought, am I in heaven? And then, you know, when a nurse came by, I kind of thought, wait a minute, you know, there's a nurse. Does it have nurses? And then, of course, as I came to, I realized, oh, I'm not dead. I'm alive. And at first, I was a little upset at the fact that I failed my suicide attempt. And then, about maybe a few moments later, I realized, oh, wait a minute, if I'm still alive, there must be something more to life. There must be something more to my life. And at that time, I remember just calling out to a God that I didn't know. I said, God, if you're there, if you're real, then show me what life is about. And, You know, he really did show me. I remember my sister at that point in time. Like, I have three sisters. One had been a Christian for about, at that time, probably 2 years. And then I have a third sister who just became a Christian. I didn't know that at the time, but she just became a Christian. And then, of course, when the family found out about my suicide attempt, they tried to talk to me, and one of my sisters spoke to me. My third sister, who happened to be a very young Christian at the time, she said, "You know, Ed, I don't know what you're going through, but you know, I think you need Jesus in your life." And I said, "Well, what's Jesus about?" And well, and she's not sure. She goes, "I think he's the Son of God, and I think through him you can have a relationship." She goes, "Wait a minute!" She runs to a room, grabs a track, and then she reads, "Well, yeah, see here. You know, you just have to say this prayer, and then, you know, you can accept him into your heart, and you know, he'll forgive you of all the bad things that you've done in life, and you become a Christian." And I kind of thought, well, that sounds all right. You know, that sounds like a fair deal. I said, I want to receive Jesus. If he's going to bring me to a relationship with God, yeah, that's what I want. I said, but one thing I want to make sure, God, I don't want religion.
Juliana.
I said, I don't want religion. I don't want to go to church. I don't want to do all these religious things, but I want a relationship with God. Now, that's how I still feel today. I don't want religion. I want a relationship with God. And that's what was always my pursuit in life, is a relationship with God. Because there's a difference. Because religion is just simply people go to... See, it doesn't matter if you go to a church, you go to a Christian school, you can come out of a Christian home. I mean, religion is just something that maybe you see people doing, you might see your parents being involved with. There's a distance between you and God. Whereas a relationship, you just find out that Jesus becomes your best friend. That's a big difference, is having Jesus as not only your personal Lord and Savior, but as your best friend. Somebody that can lead you to every point in your life, into the ways of success, into the ways of prosperity, into the ways... See, not to say that your life is not going to face hardship. You're going to face all these things. I'm not trying to put a curse on anything, but life is full of hardship. But when Jesus comes into your life, when he becomes the most important person to you, everything changes. You will learn to hear his voice. You learn to be led by his Holy Spirit. You learn what it really means to have a true friend. See, the Bible says that people, let me just read this. In Proverbs 18:24, it says, "One who has unreliable friends," and I have a lot of unreliable friends growing up, "soon comes to ruin." And that's exactly what happened to me. I had unreliable friends that brought me into the brink of suicide. "But there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother." I mean, we have, most of us have brothers and sisters, right? And, it's always nice to have a good friendship, a good relationship with your siblings, but that's not always the case. But the scripture here says that there's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And that friend is Jesus. You always do. See, when I... Remember, I made that commitment to accept Jesus into my heart, and I didn't want to go to church. And I remember that morning when I woke up, I was going to school, to a graphic arts school, and I just started to have this argument inside of me. I didn't realize at the time that was the Holy Spirit speaking to my heart. And here I'm having this argument. I said, "No, I don't want to go to church. No, I don't want to go to church. No, 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 I don't want to go to church." And I'm having this dialogue all day. Finally, when I got home, I was exhausted. I said, "Okay, I'll go to church." And then I told my sister, I said, "Okay, Joe, God, which church should go to?" And she brought me to church. And I tell you, when I first went, I had no clue what I was getting into, because I thought it was so strange. You know, I remember the church that I went to, they were singing all these songs, people were clapping, and, you know, they all seemed so happy. and they sang the song over and over again. And you know, there was one particular song, for some reason that morning, they felt like they sang it for half an hour. I mean, I'm sure it wasn't that long, but it just felt that long. And you know what crossed my mind at that point? C-U-L-T, cult. And I was ready to run out the back door. But then I learned that here is a group of people. They're engaged in worshiping. They're engaged. And they're just totally in love with God. They're totally in love with Jesus. And then I'm kind of thinking, well, you know, I can learn from this. And so week after week, month after month, you know, I just kind of learned to read my Bible, learn how to pray. And the relationship with Jesus just grew over these years. And, you know, I just think, I remember actually when I was going through some real heavy depression, and I'm talking to my friend, and then he says, well, what do you want to do in life? Do you think you can ever pull out this funk that you're in? And I said, I don't know, but I think if I'm ever going to get out of this, I think I want to be a preacher somehow. And I didn't know that, you know, that was going to actually be the case, because I remember one day when I was, just before I went to bed, I was about to go to sleep. And I just felt this strong impression, this voice speaking to me. It says, do you love me? And I said, Lord, I do love you. And he says, well, feed my sheep. And this is kind of repeated over three times. It's similar to the time when Peter was having a dialogue with Jesus when he was resurrected and he came back and he spent some time with the disciples. And then he asked Peter the same thing. And so I kind of had that moment. And so after that, I just realized that God wanted me to be in a place where I can teach and preach the Bible to other people. And so that was the beginning of my journey of entering into this type of relationship with God. Now, not all of you are going to be called, obviously, to full-time ministry. But wherever you are in life, whatever you do in life, you can be assured of this, that Jesus can always be by your side. He can always be leading you step by step, whatever you decide to do in your life. And that's something, I believe, that you can start in a very, very early stage in life. Now, if you have a relationship with Jesus, did you know that you're called to be a witness? Not because you have to, all right? But if you have a relationship with Jesus, you're automatically a witness. Now, some people kind of think, well, you know, I'm kind of nervous. I'm kind of scared to share about Jesus. Well, it's not a requirement. It's a privilege. And I want to kind of bring you into this sort of understanding. You don't have to witness. You get to witness. Can you imagine if you, let's say, your parents give you an Xbox. You know, the latest one, Xbox One X. The one that gives you 4K resolution, the highest resolution possible. And so your parents give you this, and then you get home, and they say, well, before you do your homework, you better put in a half an hour of playtime. That'll never happen, right? You have to play at least a half an hour before you get to do your homework. I mean, they're not going to ever put that requirement on you, right? You get to play at any time, right? It's a privilege. It's not a requirement. It's not an obligation. It's a privilege. See, that's how being a witness is. It is a privilege. Now, let me read one last scripture before we quit. This is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 to 20. And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. All of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sin against them. He gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. That sounds like a big word, reconciliation. It's just simply meaning introducing God and bringing them to a person that doesn't know God, sort of like bringing the two together, okay? And then it goes on to say, and so we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. How many know what an ambassador is? Some of you know what an ambassador is, right? Well, let me explain. An ambassador basically, let's say an ambassador from Africa comes to Canada. Well, he basically represents his country. He speaks on behalf of his government. He speaks on behalf of his people. He represents that country. You know, if it's an ambassador from England, same thing. He will represent Britain. He speaks for his country. You know, he's a representative. And then when the scripture says that we're Christ's ambassador, well, we represent Christ. We represent the things of God. You know, just the fact that we are a follower of Jesus, we're automatically ambassadors of Christ. And so it matters what you do. It matters how you live. Because you're a representative of heaven. Is that a heavy, heavy responsibility, you think? Being a representative of heaven. Anyways, before we close, I'd like to just give us an opportunity to pray. I don't know at this point whether you come from a Christian home, that you have Christian parents or not. I mean, it doesn't really matter. But what I want to clarify is that just because you're in a garage doesn't mean that you're a car. See, just because you're in church doesn't mean automatically you're a Christian. Just because you're in a Christian school doesn't mean you're automatically a Christian. Do you follow me? Just because you're in a garage doesn't mean you're a car. So here's what I'm saying. How do I get the assurance that I really am a Christian? It comes with a choice. It comes with a decision. Not a decision that your mom makes for you, or your dad makes for you, or for your teachers to make for you. It's a decision that you have to make by yourself. Not a decision that your friends make help you make. You have to come to terms on your own. So, won't we all close our eyes, bow our heads, no one looks